I call this regular session of the City of Glen Rose City Council to order at 5:30 on July 11th, 2016. I would ask at this moment that everyone please rise. And initially, I'd like to do a moment of silence with our thoughts going out to all of the tragedies and the survivors of those tragedies that have happened recently. Thank you. I would ask everyone to please remain standing for the invocation being delivered tonight by Ms. Sue Oldenburg, followed by the pledges of allegiance, which will be led by Councilman Marquez.
Father, as we welcome you into our midst tonight, grant that our city council follow your guidelines to lead Glen Rose in the direction of your words. Please send your angels to protect and keep safe our police, firefighters, EMT, and our military. They give so much and receive so little in return. Be there for the families of the tragedy in Dallas. They were fighting to let us demonstrate our rights. Help us to remember we are all made in your image. Help all of us to stand up and fight. Let our voices be heard. Take back our country, not allowing others to take the liberties that God has granted us. Thank you for all the blessings you have given us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Councilman Marquez.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, unto the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Roll call, Councilman Jones.
Here.
Councilman Marquez.
Here.
Councilman Moore.
Here.
Councilwoman Ramsey.
Here.
Councilman Mitchell.
Present.
All let the record reflect that all council members are present. We do have a quorum. Okay, moving to the agenda. First item on the agenda is the consent agenda. The approval of the minutes for the meeting of January 13th, 2016. June 13th, 2016. What did I say?
January.
Please know the order. I'll be okay in a minute. Council members, did you find any corrections that need to be made to the minutes?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Do I have a motion to approve the minutes as written? Councilman Marquez enters a motion to approve the minutes as written. I have a second from Councilman Moore. Councilman Jones.
Aye.
Councilman Marquez.
Aye.
Councilman Moore.
Yes.
Councilwoman Ramsey.
Yes.
Councilman Mitchell.
Yes.
That's 5 in favor, 0 against. The motion passes. All right. Next item on the agenda is the citizen and visitor comments. The City Council is always pleased to have citizens attend its meetings and welcomes comments. There are a few important points that citizens and visitors need to keep in mind. There are two opportunities for our citizens to comment. At the beginning of the meeting, citizens and visitors are given an opportunity to comment on topics that are not on the agenda. for the current meeting. During the meeting, after the council has discussed the issue before a vote, and before a vote is taken, citizens will be given an opportunity to comment on a specific agenda item. In either case, citizens wanting to comment must wait to be recognized by the mayor. After being recognized, come forward to the podium. Clearly state your full name and address. With exceptions, each citizen will have 3 minutes to speak. All comments are to be addressed to the mayor. No individual council members, or not individual council members. We, the council, are governed by the Texas Open Meetings Act. This means that we cannot discuss, answer questions, or vote on any item that is not on the agenda for the current meeting. The mayor can only respond to your comments with specific factual information or existing policy. Please remember that negative, inflammatory, or disparaging remarks will not be tolerated. I request at this time that everyone in the council chambers ensure that your cell phones are off or set to vibrate. I also advise council that they are not to text or browse on their cell phones or similar type devices during the meeting. Are there any, I have two individuals listed in the sign-in sheet who wish to speak. Ms. Briscoe, is this on an agenda item or a non-agenda item?
It's not agenda.
All right, if you could please kindly step to the podium at this time, clearly state your name and address.
I'm Barbara Briscoe. I live at 6007 Justine Court in Macon Plantation. I have a store at 102 Walnut, Stratton Step Boutique. And I just wanted to, a couple of things. I wanted to say, I love Glen Rose. I think it's the best kept secret in the entire world. And we have a gold nugget here, and I would love to see it continue to be polished and be able to share it with people. And one of the things I wanted to say is 10% of my business I feel comes from Oakdale Park. And so I'm really excited about the things you've decided to kind of do with Oakdale and keep it polished and running so that people will want to stay there. The other thing I wanted to say is I get a lot of positive comments about Oakdale, and I've had a few negatives, but more positive than negatives. So just wanted to say that, and thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, Ms. Briscoe. The next individual on the list is William Green. Mr. Green, is this agenda or not agenda?
Not agenda.
That if you would please come up to the podium. Thank you.
My name is William Green. I live County Road 302-1009. And I was at the meeting Saturday, and I just had a question. I thought it was a workshop meeting, but we didn't get to respond after y'all made some discussions on various things. We did get to talk at the first of the meeting. So I had a question for you, Mayor. Oakdale Park, is there a guest or visitor policy in place that y'all are using at this time?
It has not been approved by the council as of yet. There are some rules. That is one of the issues that was discussed during the workshop, and the council realizes, and there was a committee established to start getting that together with respect to policies.
So you don't have a public policy that anybody can get a copy of at this time?
Not at this time.
And on that same token, fee schedule, is there a fee schedule that y'all are using that's public, or?
Yes, sir. That was also discussed at the meeting. There is a fee schedule that is being used by the park that has been in place for a while. Again, however, it was noted at the workshop that fee schedule has not been passed by the council, which it does need to be passed by the council. And that is also something that is in the works and will be taken care of here very shortly. But the one that is currently in effect, it is my understanding, has been the one that has been used for quite some time now.
Okay. Neither one of those were passed by the council?
Not as of yet, no sir.
Okay. Fine. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other individuals in the audience wishing to make comments at this time on non-agenda items? Then at this point, we'll move on to the individual items for consideration. Item 6A is discussion and possible action regarding approval of purchasing a booth at the TML Exhibit Hall at the TML Conference 2016, which is coming up in October. And it would be showcasing the city of Glen Rose. Ms. Nobles has brought this before the council, so Ms. Nobles, if you would speak to the council and the audience about it.
Well, I had originally talked to the city of Granbury and city of Cleburne about possibly the three of us going in together on a booth. Both of those have since declined after speaking to their boards and councils. They don't see that it's a necessary or even a helpful place to go. So our city administrator suggested that I bring it to the council here to see how y'all felt about me setting up a booth at the Exhibit Hall at TML. I know those of us who have been there, people spend a lot of time in the Exhibit Hall. The reason I thought about it is when I was there last year, there were several cities that had booths out there that weren't anywhere close to the kind of booth that I put together when I'm promoting Glen Rose. And there's typically over 3,000 participants in TML. While they may be municipal people, they also take stuff back to their cities and so forth. So I am putting this on the agenda to see if this is something, because it will also require some help. I will be there the entire time working the booth with the exception of some breaks. So it will, you know, I know Dennis has volunteered to help, you know, speak about Glen Rose. And that gives him a place to actually do that instead of running all over the place and tracking people down.
I go to everybody else's booth and tell them about Glen Rose.
Yes, so now they can come to see.
Mr. Glenn.
Yes. So, but just bringing it to you to see if, I mean, my goal this year is to get us promoted outside the city, other than just the magazine and the app, to let a lot more cities know about what we have here.
Comments or questions from council? Councilman Moore?
I'm sorry. I think it's a great idea. I've been to three of the TML meetings, and I've been in the Exhibit Hall, walking around, talking to people. Like I said, promoting Glen Rose. I'm asking them at their booth, but they didn't go to Glen Rose. But then we'll have them coming around to our booth. I think it's a great idea myself, well worth the expenditure myself.
Councilwoman Ramsey?
Based on my first experience at TML, Bastrop had this unique booth set up. I've heard of Bastrop, didn't know where it was, didn't know anything about it. But because of that booth, it enticed me to know more about it and at least drive up there with a friend, who happened to be my husband at the time. But I think that this money, we're talking about a little over $1,100, it's going to bring in tourism. And if none of you saw the pictures that she used when she went to, where'd you go?
San Marcos.
San Marcos.
Travel fair.
Those people are stopping because there are no dinosaurs in there. There's no dinosaur poop.
No, it wasn't dinosaur poop.
But it was petrified.
Petrified poop. Okay, I'm sorry. I mean, well, people stopped and asked about what it was, okay? And I know that sounds, I'm sorry, but, you know, we've got unique things here. And if you've ever heard Dennis at a convention, and with Kelly, I think it'll increase our tourism and help our businesses, as Barbara was speaking about.
And for those of you who didn't see the pictures of the booth, the local attractions have been very good to me. When I go to a travel fair, Dinosaur Valley donates all kinds of fossils for me to teach people about the different dinosaurs and things that have been found here. I have my stuffed animal baby giraffe in the office. It's the size of a newborn from the fossil rim. I have our stand-up sign about Glen Rose, but so we have, everybody donates stuff to help show off what all we have here at Glen Rose, and people are amazed at what we have. Oh yes, and some of the locals are helping out to get together two giveaways, because at TML Exhibit Hall, they'll announce a free giveaway. You drop your card, you know, in a fishbowl or something, and then they'll do drawings out and do free giveaways. So I've got one hotel for sure, possibly another that are giving a night or so away, and then I've already talked to Dinosaur Valley and several other ones to put a whole package together, a little mini vacation package to get people here. So we'll have giveaways, and then I have stickers and pins. I've got little dinosaur stickers and pins and postcards and magazines and little sticky notes and all kinds of stuff. It's just pick up, you know, giveaway stuff.
Councilman Marquez.
Hi.
Hi.
For this funds, would it be pulled out of general fund or the hot tax or?
I think there will be sufficient funds in the CNBB budget. We just needed approval because this was not a budgeted item.
Okay, because this is the first time?
Mm-hmm. Yes, this was the first time.
At TML?
Yes, for a booth.
Okay.
Yes. This year is the first year we've actually gone to travel fairs, actually present ourselves, so.
I think it's a great idea.
And this is from TML last year from the city of Harlingen. So it's things like this that people take back to their cities that help to promote what Kelly is going to be doing.
Just when you're done, when this, if this gets approved, which I think it will, is there like an after action report or anything that gets pushed out, kind of like shows us pictures so that we can get a brief afterwards?
Yes, we'll.
Oh yeah, we'll make sure there's pictures and report. Uh-huh. Because as people are dropping in their business cards for, you know, the giveaways or whatever, that gives us a number of people who's, plus it also gives us contacts to start sending more stuff too, you know, contacting them more about Glen Rose and
one more question. I know you asked the other cities, but have you asked Balsa Rim to see if they wanted to come or anything? Because I know they do go to conventions too, but I didn't know if they.
I have stuff to represent Fossil Rim. It's only a 10 by 10 booth, so I have enough stuff that pretty much fills it up. So getting, you know, too many people, and they represent us in another way. There is an international fair that I'm looking at going at in February in Dallas, which is actually for travel agencies from all over the world, which will be there in Dallas, which will give us even more exposure to actual travel agents who can pick up the information and be able to do it. But, you know, I took pictures of the last one and posted them. I wore Dinosaur Valley donated t-shirts and Fossil Rim and stuff, so I was wearing stuff in the after hours programs, you know, after the booths were closed, so they could see, you know, I'm still representing Glen Rose and Dinosaur Valley State Park for Fossil Rim and that type of stuff. And they send free gift, like I've got bookmarks from Fossil Rim that people could pick up and that type of stuff. But I've not asked them to actually come and sit in just because they do that on their own.
Councilman Ramsey.
Typically, when you go there, it's a city that is representing everything that's there, not individual attractions there. It's the city, you know, projecting and promoting what's here.
Okay. Now, I've been to some conferences that are city-centric or entertainment-centric, but I've seen stuff on the floor. You know, I don't know if this is outside the realm, but you put dinosaur tracks like on the way toward Glen Rose, that'd be awful. I know that might be far-fetched, but
now that might be
like a sticker size.
I mean, the booth comes with a table, 6-foot table with a skirting on it, you know, and I could cut out little dinosaur tracks to put on the skirt, you know, we could tape them on there. I don't think that they would allow for anybody to put anything on the floor, you know, going towards it. But I have a pretty large sign. It's a 6-foot tall giraffe, and, you know, so they're going to see that. And, you know, and that's also I want to use as like a photo op, because that's some of the booths that were there last year. They had different setups of people go and have their pictures taken, you know, TML, stuff like that. So a lot of people are amazed that that's the size of a baby giraffe. So if they got to stand next to it and have their pictures taken, you know, they're like, oh, cool. So.
Ms. Nobles, as I understand, too, one of the other issues, because you're basically going to be the one up and understand Councilman Moore, the schedule that you have here, all right, can we, like, play tag with each other amongst the council members and work out something Because I know there are going to be some seminars, and of course, we want to go around and look.
Of course, that's what I said. My whole purpose will be there to be in the booth the whole time, with the exception of a lunch break and maybe a potty break every once in a while. But I'll set up the booth and I'll break down the booth, and people can just come. If you're not happen to be at a session or something like that, then we can tag team on who can come in.
How many people can the booth comfortably accommodate in any given time period?
I would prefer just two.
Okay. That helps us to better understand.
That's why I'm the first person to try and, you know, talk to the people that are standing there and to allow somebody to get back and take a picture with George.
Okay.
So more than that, I think it's just too much.
Okay. So that helps to give us all an understanding for those of us who go. How to balance that off. And can I go to Councilman Jones and then come back to you? Yes, Councilman Jones.
I'm not opposed to you going to TML for this. I mean, I want you to set up a good booth and find out what are the best booths out there. As far as the TML people, is that our, I don't think that's our best place to fish for people to come to Glen Rose. Now, like I said, I'm okay with you going down there and getting set up and learning that, but I want you to expand the program to go to the other conventions that are out there, not just travel, which is an excellent one also, but something that's non-travel. Say, I don't care if you take this booth and go to the boat show in Fort Worth to let people know that we're over here in Glen Rose, because these are people that are close enough to travel to Glen Rose and and hit those hot markets to actually get them to come to Glen Rose. So I don't mind having you expand that. So.
I have also another opportunity where I am getting a free booth at the annual Texas Bed and Breakfast Association in September. I'm one of the speakers at it, but they're also giving me a free booth to be able to promote Glen Rose as well. So, you know, I'm getting little opportunities here and there. People are starting to ask me to come to different things and stuff like that. So I am looking, this year, my goal is to hopefully travel more and get out to more conferences and stuff where I can actually show off what we have in. You know, TML is a good one, basically, so that they can take our magazines back to their CBBs or their chambers, and then I can get their information and be able to send our information out to them so that people who are visiting their cities can actually pick up information on our city and come here. So that's just a way of reaching out a lot more cities here in Texas. But there are other areas where, you know, I could get out in different venues.
Does your budget request include candies, keychains, whatever you're handing out?
I already have a lot of the promo items to give. I haven't ordered candy, but I mean, that's something I could pick up at Sam's or something, you know, just to have mints, or they have candy bars and stuff like that. But yeah, I have writing pens. I have sticky notes with our CBB logo on them. I just got stickers that says Glen Rose, Texas, Dinosaur Capital of Texas with the dinosaur on it. So they can stick them on their name badges or take them home to their kids or whatever. That's what I have. And I have the bookmarks from Fossil Rim and Dinosaur Valley sends some stuff. That they usually send the fossils and stuff to be able to show people. They can pick up a partial femur bone of an Acrocanthosaurus, or at the last fair I had sea turtle poop and sloth poop, you know, which fascinated everybody. But, you know, so it's kind of an educational experience where they don't actually never seen this stuff up close before, but it shows them just how much we have. And so I'll be hitting up all of our attractions to see what they want to send with us, you know, as more giveaways. But I do have giveaways, you know, that people can buy and fill up their bags with goodies from Glen Rose, and I will take what magazines we have left also, as well as the postcards about the app.
Councilwoman Rims?
My simple question was, does the two include, let's say you're in there, but...
That would be one of the two.
You would be one of the two. Otherwise, it would be at most two of us or two of them.
Right.
It's just two inside.
Just two inside the booth. And if Dennis was not happening to be working inside the booth, I'm sure we could send him out in the aisles to usher him toward the booth.
So,
Ms. Nobles, will you have elevator speech cards for those of us who aren't quite as fluent as you and Mr. Or Councilman Moore are about some of the high points?
Oh, yeah.
So that when we come in and say, okay, tag, you're it.
Well, on the fossils as well, at the last one, Dinosaur Valley actually sent like PowerPoint sheets with them, with a picture of them that tells you what they are, and I just set the fossil on top of it so people can read that this is a clamshell, fossilized clam, or this is this, or you know, anything like that. So it's kind of fairly easy for them just to kind of, this is what this is, this is what this is, but yes.
Any other questions, comments from council? All right, then, do I have a motion to approve as presented the authorization for Ms. Nobles to go ahead and make this event?
I make a motion to approve.
Okay, I have a motion from Councilman Marquez. Do I have a second? I have a second from Councilman Mitchell. Councilman Jones?
Aye.
Councilman Marquez?
Aye.
Councilman Moore?
Yes.
Councilwoman Ramsey?
Yes.
Councilman Mitchell?
Yes.
The motion passes 5-0 in favor. Next item on the agenda, discussion and consideration, possible action regarding Improtech Hibbs and Todd Incorporated, providing insurance services for the preparation of the Grand Avenue lift station improvements design.
Engineering.
It's been a long day. Mr. Holder?
Yes. Thank you, Mayor. Since the recent approval of the easement agreement at 906 Northeast Bernard Street between the City of Glen Rose and the Somerville County Water District, EHD has been asked to generate a work order for services for engineering the proposed lift station. The design phase of that, the construction phase of that, we covered under the grant, the EDAP grant that we received at the wastewater treatment plant. I've included the work order that was generated and the scope of services that would be provided, and the compensation would be in the amount of $60,000. That would cover the planning, preliminary design work, and the final design phase as well. We budgeted the amount, full amount for construction phase and design work. Since then, I found out that the grant will cover 100% of the construction cost. So we're looking at just $60,000 for the design work. And it's kind of time sensitive because it is under that grant. So I recommend that we move forward on this.
Current lift station's in the floodplain.
Yes.
And it's already flooded several times in the last 2 years.
Yes.
It was actually
dangerously close.
In the early 90s, I believe it wiped out like a control panel and all.
It's imperative to be moved.
And it's not adequately sized for the development that's going on in that side of the city.
Madam Mayor, members of council, one reason that this item is on the agenda, I know there's been some discussion perhaps that thought that this had previously been approved, but since it is part of the Texas Water Development Board grant and loan, we want to make sure that we keep the paperwork readily available and make sure that we've got all the T's crossed and the I's dotted. So that's the reason it's on the agenda for approval tonight.
Any other questions, comments? Council. Then do I have a motion to approve project number 5722, work order number 19, under the General Services Agreement, design of Grand Avenue lift station improvements? I have a motion from Councilman Moore. Do I have a second? I have a second from Councilwoman Ramsey. Councilman Jones?
Aye.
Councilman Marquez?
Aye.
Councilman Moore?
Yes.
Councilwoman Ramsey?
Yes.
Councilman Mitchell?
Yes.
The motion passes 5-0 in favor. Next item on the agenda is discussion, consideration, and possible action regarding Improtech Hibbs and Todd Incorporated EHT providing engineering services for the preparation of the Stoneview Lift Station improvement near Squaw Creek, also known as the Gosden property. Again, Mr. Holder.
Thank you. Much like the previous item, the easement agreement has been made, so we've secured a location. And back in 2009, we decided when we got to that point of the project, until we see further development on the east side of the city limits, that we were just gonna hold off. We're there. We have people that want to be tied on to city services in that area, so the engineering firm of EHT has been asked to generate a work order for that project as well for the design phase of that project. And it's $105,000 for that work. And that includes the survey, the planning, the preliminary design, final design phase, construction phase services, which is any inspections or help with permitting on any of the work that's going to take place.
Questions from council? Comments?
This is crucial to the future of our city. That's where our city's heading. And like I said, we've already got businesses one day in the end, or possibly the land. It's important. Tighten up.
Any additional comments, questions? Councilwoman Ramsey?
Mayor, excuse me, but we have to go into the office.
I just realized that.
I know, I'm sorry to bring it up, but I just.
And my apologies to the audience.
Yes.
Audience, any questions, comments with respect to this project? Okay, council? Do I have a motion to approve project number 5722, work order number 20 under general services agreement, design of Stoneview Lift Station improvements, Highway 67?
So moved.
I have a motion from Councilman Moore. Second from Councilman Jones. Councilman Jones?
Aye.
Councilman Marquez?
Aye.
Councilman Moore?
Yes.
Councilwoman Ramsey?
Yes.
And Councilman Mitchell?
Yes.
The vote is 5-0. The motion passes. Agenda item number 6D is discussion, consideration, and possible action regarding approval of CBB grant application and amount recommended by the CBB Advisory Board for the Biloxi Pedal Race in October. Ms. Knowles?
Okay, this was brought back from last month after the board had recommended $6,000, and this is actually the first time the Biloxi Pedal has ever asked for money. In the past, the CBB has just helped out with advertising and publicity and so forth, so the board agreed to go ahead and fund them $6,000. The total cost of the project is $11,500. The board recommended the $6,000, and that's just to be used for, if you'll notice on page 4, H and I, which is publicity and promotions and printing. The printing of all the material and publicity and promotions, which is ads in the Biker magazine, some promoting Glen Rose t-shirts, all that kind of stuff. So.
Questions from council? Councilman Moore?
This directly benefits Council Riley State Park.
Well, it benefits the LDL Foundation, right. Which is actually, this is the educational side of it,
okay.
Not necessarily Dinosaur Valley State
okay.
Park. This is for the educational side of the LDL Foundation,
okay.
Which helps out a lot of the stuff in the schools and So it's that section of the foundation.
Something that stays in.
Stays in the community, yes.
Any other questions, comments? Councilman Marquez?
Number 11 on the in application, when this gets approved, they could just have another added on there. Just a synopsis of kind of like the other application that we're going to come for the more in the next application. Number 11, the description. Then number 13, just to make sure that you're saying that all this money is going to go toward publicity and promotion and printing, right?
Yes.
And in turn, that's when next time I ask for it, you'll see
expense report.
The expense report to show what they spent.
Okay.
Any other questions? Any questions or comments from the audience regarding this grant? Then do I have a motion to approve the CBB grant of $6,000 to the Biloxi Pedal Race in October of this year?
That's all motion.
I have a motion from Councilman Mitchell. I have a second from Councilman Marquez. Councilman Jones?
Aye.
Councilman Marquez?
Aye.
Councilman Moore?
Yes.
Councilwoman Ramsey?
Yes.
Councilman Mitchell?
Yes.
That's 5-0 in favor. The motion passes. Next item on the agenda is discussion, consideration, and possible action regarding approval of CBB grant application and amount recommended by the CBB Advisory Board for the Texas Time Trials. Again, Ms. Nobles.
Texas Time Trials is another bicycling event. It's a fairly large event. And last year they were awarded $3,500. This year the board recommended $3,500. The only thing that money is used for is the t-shirts for all the participants and people to possibly purchase. This is one that the mayor received last year, so you can see that our logo is on the front, all about Glen Rose and so forth. So this is the way they advertise and do their publicity for us. So the money is strictly just for the t-shirts.
Questions?
Where do they purchase those shirts?
They have a company that they sent the bid that they attached that pictures of. It's based, Sport Tech is the company that they get the t-shirts from. Apparently they buy almost all their t-shirts for all the different time trial events from them, so they get more of a discounted price because they use them for all their t-shirts for different time trials.
I'd ask in the future if they maybe use one of the t-shirts here, if there's a comparable cost. We have a couple of t-shirt places within the city that they might get a better deal for less being local here.
Mm-hmm. I can ask them for future.
Is the logo embroidery? Did it look like from here?
No, it's all it's all colored, but it's all screen printed.
And the other sponsors are all in the back, so we got front and center from last year's. Ms. Doubles, this is Texas Time Trials has been doing their time trials here in Glen Rose for how long now? I know we've got a lot of the trophies out here. Do you know when they first started? Or
I don't know the exact date they first started. I know they've been here at least 5 or 6 years,
yeah.
Or probably more than that.
So this
I've only been here about 5 years, yeah. So.
And Councilman Moore, do you know Councilman Ramsey? How long the Texas Time Trials has been doing there?
It's probably 10, I think, more like 10.
I know that when we lived down on 56 South on the farm, and then we moved there in 98,
mm-hmm.
I believe they were going through in 99
close to 20 million.
So maybe even 2,000, but you know, they only wrote down that one.
Yeah, so 10 plus.
How many heads and beds do you think they're doing?
Texas time trials, they don't have that number, but I've talked to two of the hotels who are going to pay attention to that, and they do bring in quite a few heads and beds at that time, because it's another one of those cycling events that people kind of stay 2 or 3 days because they want to practice the route and, you know, get accustomed to if it's going to be extreme heat, humidity, or whatever.
So three of our big hotels are right there plus where they
have the because that's where they usually start it, is right there by two or three of our main hotels, so they can just walk down there and get started.
Yeah, and if I recollect correctly from last year, Vintage Market Days also came in the same weekend that the Texas time trials were, and they had a hard time finding a hotel. A lot of their vendors had to stay in Granbury because the Texas time trials already had the two hotels up there on the hill by the Sonic Park completely booked. They were jam-packed. And the riders for this event don't come from just local. They come from all over the United States. There was also a rider from Germany and a rider from England who have historically come several years in a row last year. So this is a pretty well-known and well-attended event.
I just want them to pass that this application is very nice. This number 11 is a good brief description. They have their deliverables, their expense, and everything broken down to understand.
Questions or comments from the citizens on this item? Yes, Ms. Prisco.
I think anything.
Please, to the podium. Thank you.
I believe any event that brings business into the city and can promote the city is beneficial. Because as a small business owner, we need people to come, we need exposure. And the more exposure we get, the more repeat business we get from that exposure.
Any other questions or comments from the audience? Council? Then at this time, do I have a motion to approve a grant of $3,500 for the Texas time trials to be conducted in September 22nd through the 24th of 2016? I have a motion from Councilman Marquez. Do I have a second? I have a second from Councilman Mitchell. Councilman Jones?
Aye.
Councilman Marquez?
Aye.
Councilman Moore?
Yes.
Councilwoman Ramsey?
Yes, ma'am.
Councilman Mitchell?
Yes.
The motion passes 5-0 in favor. Next item on the agenda is the investment report. Mr. Nolan?
Madam Mayor, members of the council, as a requirement of the state, we are required to provide you with an investment report detailing our investments that the city currently has. You have been included in all of the cash accounts that we have and fund accounts. You will note that we only have actually one investment, and that's with TexPool. We have a little over $2 million invested with TexPool in various investment options. They're mostly stable. There are bonds. The yield is about 0.51%. It varies from 4.9 to 5.1. The balance and preponderance of the funds that the city currently has is in demand deposits with First Financial Bank. The third group of items that you're provided with are the safekeeping documents that Frost Bank holds, the certificates of various investment options, or in not investment options, but the various securities that First Financial is obligated to pledge for the coverage of the funds that we have in their bank. So that's just some additional information for you, just a safeguard. First Financial does indeed have those investment securities, and the safekeeping receipts are in the hands of Frost Bank, so it's not something that First Financial could cash and do something with without our approval or authority or knowledge. So those are just for your information. It does not require a vote of the council. It's just a matter that we have to report to you. Yes, ma'am.
So the amount here shown for the 4B tax is roughly $413,000.
I believe that's
actually in the bank account?
Yes.
Okay.
40 minutes.
Pardon?
We still have all the payments coming up.
So if it's half of that, that leaves us.
Any other questions from council members? Councilman Moore?
We talked about some concern about having all the money in one bank.
Yes, sir, and that will be something I will be moving a portion of the funds that we currently have with First Financial. I'll be moving those to tax pool. We also have two other opportunities, Logic and Techstar, which are the council had approved at a prior meeting for placement of funds, and so we will be moving probably 50% or more of the money out of First Financial, since we get a little bit better rate of return on the money with Techpool, Techstar, and Logic. One tenth of a hundredth of a percent, that's not much, but it is something. So we will be doing something with it.
So according to my math, we've got around $162,000 for projects with 4B money. If you take out the Oakdale payment, is that correct? Is that the way I'm reading it?
We have an interest payment, and we have a principal payment that are both, and I'm not right. Sure which
around
one.
$250,000, so.
Yeah, they both come due. We make an interest and a principal payment in August, and then we make an interest payment in February. Councilman Moore, I would have to say I don't know exactly how much we will have left, but your calculations sound about right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can I push you?
Well, I just subtracted $250,000.
Okay.
I think it was like $276,000. Okay. The total amount is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Principal and interest.
Okay. $276,000. So they dropped that.
Leaving to
$130,000. I was guessing. Just rough logic.
Any other questions or comments? Any questions from the audience? This again is for information only for the council. With no further questions or comments, move on to the next agenda item, which is staff reports. And we begin with Public Works.
Thank you, Mayor. First thing I wanted to update y'all on was the smoke testing of the sewer collection system. We're still working on this project, but we've slowed down considerably just due to the needs in other areas of maintenance. So that's something that's going to be ongoing. We hope to complete that within the next couple of months, but just going to depend on what else is going on throughout the city. The Nancy Drive, Jefferson Street Alley Survey, on June 17th, the final notice letter was sent to the different property owners that still are encroaching on the alleyway. I believe the letter is going to allow the property owners until July 18th to vacate that property. And at that time, I'm not sure what, I believe Stephanie's going to handle that out of the code enforcement office. The Riverwalk and Big Rocks, the mayor and city administrator and I walked through that with FEMA to kind of give them an idea and let them take photos or whatever they needed to do for their end of the research that they do before this whole process starts. And I'm working on preparing an itemized list of estimated costs to repair the damaged structures. And it's going to be pretty costly. I've met with Chris Hay with the HT, and it's pretty substantial, the amount of damage to two of the different structures down, actually three different structures. We're looking at full replacement cost is what he's recommending. So it's probably several hundred thousand. I don't know if y'all want to put that back like it was, or if we want to maybe check in the mitigation and go ahead.
Oh, no, I'll let you finish.
Oh, okay. Anyway, we just think we have a couple contractors that are going to look at it, and they're going to give us their opinion as well, and we'll move on from there. Do you have a question on that?
No, I would agree. I mean, with the lighting itself, we use the common normal electricity that you ran conduit to it for the lighting, and now all the lights are gone. Maybe look into using solar panels or something like that to be self-sufficient within it. And then look at Texas Parks and Wildlife's water trails and park trails grants, because I think there's only four water trail parks within the state of Texas that use those grants. So you might be able to pull that if we can use stability with the canoe that they come in and they get off. That creates it as a water trail for canoers. Oh. So you might want to look into that and probably put that estimation. Because if we don't have to run electricity anymore and we're just using solar for the lighting there, then it could save us money in the long run. So if you do that, I'd ask less.
Okay. And then the last item on there was just quick update on the wastewater treatment plant project. We'll be meeting with the representatives from EHT on Wednesday to kind of review the plans that they submitted last, and hopefully we can move forward on that when the funds are available. I think that's July 13th, I believe.
Actually, it's tomorrow is when the funding actually occurs. We will have access to the funds on Wednesday, but the actual funding occurs tomorrow. We have submitted all the necessary paperwork, tax certificates, etc., to accomplish that.
That sums it up for me. Do y'all have any questions on
I just got a comment for the audience. Some of you may not understand, but when we talk about the Oakdale bond, the Riverwalk was part of that. Well, when we were saying we're paying the Oakdale note, the Riverwalk was funded out of that too. So it's just not Oakdale. We're talking about paying back the $200. Yeah. The Riverwalk was funded through that.
All right, council. Any other council members for the staff? Questions? CBB, Ms. Nobles.
Okay. I've been working with Loretta with the Clear the Shelter program, getting that promoted, and be volunteering as well to work out there with the cats and so forth, so I've been working on that. My biggest announcement for the month of June is that, in case you haven't noticed, our dinosaurs are now back alive. They look lively. I've had lots of people stop, take pictures of them, you know, with them, and so they look great. And I just want to thank Audrey Smith, Teresa Fernandez, Mr. Haney from the high school art department for doing that for us. So they look awesome and alive again. Another thing I'd like to just point out that I feel is impressive is that our average number of visitors for the month of June has gone up from 6.5 last year to 9.2 this year. That's per day. So we are getting a lot of people coming in per day, asking questions, wanting to know where to go eat, where to go shop, what's the best attractions, what time is this open, what time is that open. And a lot of them, once they hear and see what all we have, they're like, oh, we need to probably stay a little bit longer or come back, you know, another time. So we're getting a lot more foot traffic coming through the office, you know, to ask questions and find out what's going on. So I feel like that's a great thing that's happening.
And then, just if you didn't notice, the app is almost up to 1,000 downloads on the app. So, those are the highlights that I thought. Anybody have any questions?
I have a quick question. How are we doing on our supply of the Glen Rose magazine?
We're getting low. I'm in the process of putting together a new ad campaign to go out. I've already had a lot of people approaching me about putting an ad in the magazine since it's come out, and they're like, oh, this is a cool looking magazine. You know, why didn't we put an ad in it? So I have quite a few people to go and hit up about getting that so we can get another run done.
Are we going to have the space to add, or are we just going to go for a reprint and then of what we currently have? And
we'll have a reprint because those who already have ads in there, that was a 2-year ad.
Right.
But we will have space to add more, okay, you know, ads in it. And then, you know, there's a few corrections that need to be made in it that people have caught here and there, you know, so we'll go through and make those corrections. Sean and I have been keeping a list of, you know, this needs to be photoshopped, and this address needs to be corrected, and, you know, this phone number needs to be corrected. So just a few little things like that. But yes, there are a lot of people who are now wanting to be in the magazine or as an ad in, so I think it turned out much better than anybody anticipated, and they've gone out much faster than I anticipated.
We tried to tell them. Mm-hmm.
But now they have proof in their hands. So, comments? Councilman Marquez?
I really enjoy looking at these Facebook posts, numbers, differentials of the iPhone use. I just have a couple of recommendations from the Facebook posts. These are basically pages that are liked overall. Do they also include when you share them?
No. These are just ones that, yeah, and this is just from the CVB Facebook. It doesn't include when I go and forward it on and put it on Hood County, Erath County, Bosque County, Johnson County, all of the other Facebook places that I post all that stuff on. This is strictly the statistics that we have through our CVB Facebook page.
Okay. The other reason why I ask is if you want to share this with, like, Arlington County or Arlington's CVB over there, you probably get a little bit more increase. And the second one is that as I go to other places, I see that app, you know, go to Glen Rose apps. Maybe look into, when you revise it, to put a QR code on there, the square black and white code that you can just take a picture of it, and it'll automatically go to the download site for that, so you don't have to type it in. So it'll be easier on a window.
I'd have to check the price on that because
it's free. I mean, when you add it on there. And also, if you'll probably start seeing it on real estate agent tags. They have this big old block box. You can do the same thing right in front of the CVB board, and you can just take a picture of it. Might get an increase in there, too. So.
Okay, thank you. Anything else?
Other comments, questions?
Audience? Okay. Oakdale Park?
Eric, y'all have a copy of my monthly report. There was a late ad your monthly report, some photographs that were taken along the Mark Street in section C. We have a power pole that's basically being held up by a baling wire up against the top rail of the cyclone fence. If you look down at the bottom, that's the picture of that very same power pole. Also along that fence line, it appears to be that we've got, help me out, just four great big sinkholes along that fence line, just inside the fence. It has been roped off. It has been taped off with caution tape to keep people out temporarily. I don't know that we've made any progress on getting panels in there yet, but nobody's going to be using that area until we get it fixed. I have a call into an electrician now to come out and give me an estimate on getting that power pole moved. And the other big one was we had 3 arrests at Oakdale over the 4th of July. One for shooting on the candles at people in RVs. I think the other one was public intoxication. And what was the third one? Possession.
Because they were not residents of the park, they were passing through. They were local residents, but they were not staying at the park.
Possession is in drugs, illegal drugs.
And the new chlorination system is working well.
And I was also out there walking, and these sinkholes are pretty good size, but the other thing is that over time, the water that's going through and washing out is like undermining the fence, and that there are portions of that, of the rock retaining wall there, that are actually starting to lean forward, so.
Is it part of this problem because people jump the fence to those big rocks? Part of the reason this fence is leaning?
You can see that there's a fence post in that, and I don't know that the picture does it justice, but there's a fence post in there that's been pushed out, and I don't believe it's coming from people jumping the fence.
I know I've seen people.
Yeah, at the base, it's not, I don't believe it's from people jumping the fence, because it's at the base where it's actually washed out.
Yeah, this actually, if you see, it actually, you can see where it's washed out, not bending. Okay, any other questions, Councilwoman Ramsey?
For Oakdale?
For Oakdale.
Yes. Related to the tent thing, or y'all working together to maybe find other tent areas so we don't lose the tent people? And whether it's the 5 acres, or I know way before Kelly came, they used to camp out, you know, back in the back part of where the stage area. So are we looking at other areas too?
Yeah, it's going to be one of those situations. This particular area is an improved campsite. They have water and electricity. And there really are limited spaces. We can move them up around the picket shed or some of those other areas, or even over to the 6 acres. It's actually 6 acres, 5.97.
Okay.
So we can move them over there.
A different rate.
Yes.
Than the water.
And this only involves, I believe, what, 6 spaces?
Maybe.
I think that's correct. But we'll be working to get that done as soon as possible. That one pole, it's hard to say. David didn't really expound on it, but it's hard to say whether the pole is holding the fence up or the fence is holding the pole up. It's tied with baling wire, of course, baling wire and duct tape, whatever
you need.
Until it breaks.
I commend you for discovering that today, because we are talking about electricity. So may I make another comment that I'd like to address too?
Absolutely. It's your turn to make comments to the staff.
Okay. I was going to talk with you, and then I love to go on vacation and we didn't get together. But I'd like to see the monthly financial report reflect more like the budget, where, and I'd like to meet with both of you, but just like supplies, snack bars, and those kind of things to not be under capital expenditures, because they are the operating cost and the capital expenditures. But I do want to commend you that taking out the capital expenditures and looking at the revenue, this is for the audience. Oakdale for the month of June showed a $20,229.35 profit. And that's taking out the capital expenditures, because those are already budgeted and another line item. So I just like to meet with y'all regarding that. So,
Councilor Moore?
I had a question about why we're getting the incident reports about stubbed toes and such. That's something we need.
Council needs to be aware of that. As it says in the report, incidents are warning signs that all pertains to the deck.
Since you could give us the financial report, I don't know why we need to get the receipts, because I think if we personally had a question about the receipts.
Those receipts are there to show what the customer signed for.
What the customer?
If you look, it's highlighted, the fireworks ordinance is highlighted on those receipts.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
It's all right.
I didn't do that. And rather than give us call logs, can you just put like X amount of calls, that you received.
The reason the call logs were included in the report was I heard there were allegations being made that Oakdale was not answering the phone and Oakdale was not returning phone calls. That's why.
But I'm not being critical.
That's why the call logs are there.
So after this, can we just take your word for it?
Yes, ma'am.
Unless another councilman has a objection to that.
Councilman Jones?
I'd like to see the call logs at least once periodically.
Pardon?
I'd like to see the call logs, but that's not one.
Okay. That's okay.
On the pool revenue on June 2015, if I get my dates right, listed $23,400. In June 2016, it's $3,500. We know the pool wasn't open timely this year. Did we really make $20,000?
No, that's got to be a miss. That's got to be probably my dyslexic brain or a typo.
Yeah, that just looks like an incredible amount of money.
Probably a typo.
1 month, so.
It's probably a typo.
No, I think that's
an actual amount of money.
Actual.
We made off the pool last year.
For the entire year?
No, the month.
The month of June was $23,000.
That's pretty close, if not.
For the year?
No, for June.
The month of June.
That's the biggest pool month of the year. That's pretty close, if not.
Any other comments, questions?
I can check that for you.
Okay, I'd kind of like to get a clarification here because I have one council member who said that the call logs didn't need to continue to come in the packets. I have another council member who indicated they'd like to receive them. Kind of like to give the park manager an up or down. Councilman Marquez.
I'd like to make a recommendation for the call logs. Most of them are inquiries or reservations regarding normal business. If you do have call logs, it would be easier just to put a plus inquiry minus a negative comment and then just do a running total. You receive 600 calls, 30 of them were negative, and you follow up with 30 of them, or 20 were negative. So we don't get the big call log, but we get the gist of it, and maybe highlight one or two that you might feel would be need follow up by either you or someone else in the future. I mean, I think that would be better. It doesn't take that much more space just to put a positive and negative and inquiry and one or two highlighted that you might need.
Okay, so I'm hearing is basically if it's four reservations or a return call pertaining to a reservation, that is basically a positive type call, just a total of how many of those, and then a total of how many negative with the highlight. Councilman Jones, would that suffice for you?
Totally.
Okay. Everyone else? Okay. That will make hopefully the paperwork on your end a little bit easier also. All right. Any other questions from council or comments? Yes, Councilwoman Ramsey.
Basically, all you had to do with this was just make copies. You didn't have to, other than making copies, there's nothing special that you had to do on the phone call thing. Is that correct?
That's created an Excel spreadsheet.
So can't they just, instead of having to do the thing, can't they just put whether it's a reservation with an R and I mean, I'm just throwing this out. Reservation with an R and comment with a C. I mean, I'm just throwing it out. Whatever.
Yeah, this is exactly the, I mean, I agree. It's the exact same way. I mean, we don't need to see the call logs, but you do have call logs, and that shows us that you have a call log. Just a running total of 50 or 60. They can break it down per week so that you can just total them up at the end of the month. So.
It's good.
Okay.
Just thorough.
Okay. Any other questions, comments, or Oakdale? Then we're on to police department.
I have nothing further, but most of the council has any questions about your monthly.
I do have one quick question. I know that the sheriff's department handled that incident that happened out at the intersection. Was the gentleman that was involved in the accident? Did you hear any word back? I understand that was a Glen Rose resident.
Not.
Okay.
It's been on the day.
Okay, so far as you know, all right.
The copy we have of somebody's driver's license or something, is that, or that, is that from the incident at the park, or?
Says Texas Commission Enforcement Officer.
No, that was from the alcohol party.
No, sir.
They got in trouble with alcohol?
No, that was their security because they were serving alcohol at home.
I thought we had to prove those.
David got with me and asked me, I said, just long as he gets the credentials.
I thought the council had to prove it.
Was that in connection with an event?
No, it was just a wedding reception.
I think they approved it as long as he got with me and that's last time the child approved that.
We have to approve those.
We need to check into that because there is a specific procedure, I believe, that Ms. Noble's got passed with paperwork, and it does have to go through council approval.
It's a special event permit.
I don't know if you were aware of that, but we'll get with that and get that fixed for future. Because something like a wedding reception or something, they're making advance reservations, that's one of the things that needs to be identified. We'll talk about that afterwards with city administrator.
They approved it with the special event permit that had to come before council to be approved in order to have that.
Okay, so let me make sure. Because I write, don't always concentrate as much as I should. The ID picture we have was not the person arrested. He was the person that...
That was the officer that was providing security.
All right, thank you.
And he was providing security because there was a call at the wedding reception. All right, animal control, is there anything to add to that, Police Chief? Code enforcement?
Anthony Rufino's Camelot Phase 3 is bonded for the maintenance bond, and they've formally been finalized and started 3 houses. And he feels bad, he feels very relieved. Thank you for letting him move forward. Oakdale Park, looking at the fire lane that was also brought up at that meeting, that never was a fire lane, never needed to be a fire lane, and the fire chief and the fire marshal have agreed that they only 2 exits are required to be fire lanes for that size park, so that can be sealed off and that sign removed. And actually, later, if it's chosen to even vacate that road and eliminate it, it's unnecessary, but that's a choice that you have later. We have meetings coming up, Planning and Zoning Board will have a zone change 7/18/2016 at least to present for zone change, 600 Crockett Street from R3 to B1, and of course R3 allows mobile homes, B1 is a restricted business, and to tie it with the nice sweet Magnolia Market that's there, it may improve the neighborhood, and we'll see how it's presented and how the neighborhood handles that. There will be a replat application that evening as well in Tuscan Village, of which 4 lots will be made into 3. It's unusual for development to make their lots bigger, but it will probably not be opposed because it will be going the direction of less intensity. The Preservation Board will conduct their regular scheduled meeting, and many of the things the Preservation Board have done, they brought up each time and then not talked about them, brought them and not talked about them. This time, we will basically only talk about the review of the preservation ordinance, and they were given that assignment before to go over it carefully, so those comments can be brought out in the open of what their thoughts are. And I thank you, Mayor, and some of the others for the comments you made on that, as I'm a little bit new on this. Last month, the Preservation Board, Mayor Swarian, the new members, and that would be Joyce Selby, Tom Osborne, Linda Peacock was not present, but she'll be sworn in. Betty Gosden was voted in as the chair again, and Larry Garnett was voted in as the vice chair. The other meeting that we have coming up on 7/20, Board of Adjustment will be dealing with an in-ground swimming pool, of which we had two that just kind of popped in on both sides, and we're giving, an okay before, and to try to do these things a little more officially and go through the changes. The Board of Adjustment will be dealing with the setback issues on this long, narrow, expensive lot that has swimming pools beside it, and they're asking for a little bit of adjustment in the setbacks for what they need. There are construction projects that come in. None of them are really official, so I don't feel proper to speak about it until they are, because then it would not let them negotiate of what they may or may not be thinking of, and it would kind of bring it out in the open when it's not time to bring it out in the open until they either file a permit or file for a zone change. But we have about four places where they've talked about perhaps changing the zone for a duplex or a fourplex, and so there's activity out there. I feel good about that.
Do you have an idea of when the council can expect to receive that preservation board or ordinance revision for council review and consideration?
This will be the first time that I have sat there where they've actually discussed it. I was hoping that Ray would be there the last meeting. I don't know if they were really ready. They had their plate too full this time. This is what we are going to talk about. They've been given the papers. They've all been given the papers. And we should hopefully be able to come up with a good working model. It's hit and miss. If it's enough that we think we can congeal it and try to get it in your hands within a month, probably 2 months at max, I want to see it move forward quickly.
Because I know this has been a process that's been going on for about 3 years now in attempts to do this. Questions from council?
What's the status? You may already mention it. I missed it. The Austin Road Apartments, Mr. Davis, the senior citizen living apartments.
That has been permitted, and they are scratching the ground. Okay, which I was called playing in the dirt. If you're playing in the dirt.
That's still going.
Yeah, that's playing in the dirt.
It's just slow.
Yeah, it's playing in the dirt.
But it still doesn't work.
That's common. That it looks like a very clean project. There's six plexes. On building issues on those, as the structures get larger, it gets into fire sprinklers, which are expensive, but there is a way to 2-hour wall and separate those, which is a legal alternative for fire sprinklers, and that's probably the way he's going to go. That we've been drawn on there for him to do that to save him money.
Any other questions, comments for code enforcement? City Administrator, Kat, you're it.
Mayor and Council, only have two items. One is at the next council meeting, we'll bringing an ordinance to you concerning the handling of liquid waste at our wastewater treatment plant. We've had a request from a company that would like to discharge domestic waste, probably no more than 2,000 gallons per week, probably somewhat less than that. Currently, we have no ordinance that allows that, and quite honestly, I don't see any problems with the city accepting that. Generally, at the rate of discharge that they're talking about, on a projected cost of 20 cents a gallon, they would bring in probably $1,000 a month or more. Certainly not anything to sneeze at, but it would certainly help the coffers a little bit, and certainly help a concern that envisions at some point moving inside the city limits. As you're all painfully aware, we cannot annex except by petition from the property owner, and they have indicated a willingness to do so. The other item is scheduled a 4B meeting for Thursday afternoon at 5:30. We will be considering a loan to VRC, which is a company that the council visited back in, I believe, in March, April. They have purchased acreage over in Bo Gibbs Park and are currently in the process of doing the groundwork to erect a, I believe it's a 40 by 200 foot building, which they have already purchased. This will be a loan that will be repayable, a zero interest loan. They have met all of the criteria that the county and the city have established regarding their financial viability. They have approximately 15 permanent employees and about 85, I won't say temporary, but 85 contract employees that currently work all over the United States. They refurbish gas compressors and make repairs, and it's going to be a pretty good sized operation in the park. And again, they're building the shop first, and then they also have plans for an office building that they will be constructing also, and that will be at the end of the cul-de-sac over in Bo Gibbs Park.
This is going to be similar to the loan that was structured through the 3A agreement with
yes.
Mr. Williams?
Yes.
Okay.
Be very similar.
Any other questions from Ms. Sterling? Check register, fuel use report. Anything on that? All right. Then at this point, unless there are other questions from council,
did
yes.
Did I miss member, council member reports? I may have missed anything on that.
Pardon?
The item 7, council member reports.
We didn't have any. I'm aware.
One.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, it wasn't on my agenda for me to know.
Oh, please. I had to tell you ahead of time.
I thought
it was a general open item. I didn't know you had to.
Well, this is the first time I've ever had this question. City Secretary, do we need to know about that ahead of time? Because right now the agenda doesn't indicate there's any.
Mayor, actually, under the Texas Open Meetings Act, it is required that you at least have an item listed.
That's a problem.
Particularly if you are aware beforehand of it.
Right. It's just it's just information. It's not.
Is that, if it's an announcement, that's okay.
It's just information about sales tax revenues.
That can fall under announcements.
Okay. Does that fall under announcements?
Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
It's not. It's just information.
I didn't skip this. I didn't have any notes here to tell me to go to Councilman Moore.
Well, I didn't know if you had to do that or not. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. So that would be under item 11, announcements, so if you want to go ahead and...
Okay. I keep track of the sales tax. Our sales tax receipts for July were $8,422.44, which means we're up 11.84% from $73,693.44 last year. That's actually May's receipts.
Yes.
And then we're up for the year at 4.11%. This year's total tax receipts, that's including hot tax, $552,639.55. Last year at this time it was $530,780.58. So we're up 4.11% for the year and 11.84% for the month. That's all.
Thank you, and my apologies.
No problem.
We'll have that for future reference then. Any other announcements? All right, there being no further business on the agenda. This meeting is closed at 6:15.